welcome, Achievers, to your Easy Achievers Game Podcast for the week of April 25th. I'm your host today. We're going to be having a chat, you and I, as we delve into the news for the week. It does not seem like much is happening. It doesn't seem like we're getting anything too crazy, but we do get into depths in one of my favorite news stories, of course, in the thumbnail of this video, and Embracer completely collapsing like a dying star. As we've talked about every week, new week, new Embracer story, of course. Unfortunately, we have to keep talking about this company until it's dead. I don't want to ignore anything, so of course we'll be covering that again. We have some developments in recent game releases. We have some testing. I mean, I think it's been a busy week for literal games, not necessarily the news around them, but it's kind of been that good for a while. It's kind of been chill. We're still in kind of the wait and see phase, I feel like. Kind of waiting for something big to happen, right? It's been a while since we've had a really big news story to really peel back and discuss. So sit back, relax, enjoy the show. Let me know in comments below your thoughts on anything about the show. Of course, this is an open discussion, so if there's something in the show that you disagree with or want to have an open dialogue about, of course, comment below. I answer them all. You can, of course, tweet at me at EVM9000. And we can get that discussion going. I want to thank everyone for stopping in today. Of course, timestamps in the description below. And let's get started. I want to open the show a little bit with, of course, we're going to get into Not So Happy Power, but I want to talk about kind of my gaming schedule right now. We're going to get into what you've been playing, but I feel like I am being inundated with so much right now. Like, so much games and life events. Of course, Destiny is about to have its maybe final expansion as Destiny 2, and maybe we'll be getting in a new game later. Who knows? There's some reporting on a potential sequel. Maybe, maybe not. Who knows? But we are getting into quite the busy schedule, I think. And now, luckily, Stellar Blade comes out actually Friday. So tomorrow, as of recording, but of course, as you're listening to this, that's already live. Reviews are out there. We'll be covering that not so rapid fire, but I can't wait to play some of that. Eiyuden Chronicles is out now. Cannot wait to dig. I mean, I have so many games at my disposal. I, of course, need to go back to Banishers, Ghost of New Eden. I need to go back to so many games, and I'm going to be very busy for a while, and I'm very excited about that. I'm very excited. I have plenty of games to kind of fill my summer, honestly. I still want to go back to Rebirth and all these things. I want to know what everyone's playing out there. What are you enjoying recently? Do you have as busy a schedule as I do, or just not clicking with a lot of these games? Because I feel like I am being completely overwhelmed with how many games that I want to delve into. Until then, let's start the show. Not so rapid fire. BlizzCon will be skipping this year. They said they would look forward to future years, but they will not be having a BlizzCon this year. I assume, I don't know if this is quite a surprise for me. I mean, it's Blizzard, maybe, you know, the shakeup from the Microsoft purchase and all these things, maybe they haven't set up in the correct way yet, so maybe they need a year to process, but that's unfortunate. I like BlizzCon. I like that they have these kind of things that everyone can go to and have fun at, so I wish they stuck with it, but I imagine they're still kind of restructuring, right? Isn't it like 6 months before a major transition like that until everything's kind of moving along, right? So they might be close to being done with the restructuring, but that's a massive company. So they might still be in the midst of, you know, weird transitioning phase. Who knows? Stellar Blade launches Friday with great reviews already out and a day one patch containing New Game Plus. Now, we have the reviews. They're all out there. Seems like a general consensus that it is pretty good. Of course, I don't really care about review numbers, but everyone seems, if you want to, you can see the Metacritic score. I think it was around an 80 or something, if you care about that. But general sentiment seems like it's good. It seems like exactly what we expected. It might be that the story is probably the weakest part of the game, which is unfortunate because I liked the setting. It seemed like it had a Nier Automata vibe with these androids saving this kind of planet sort of thing, but maybe it's not as intriguing as I thought it would be at first glance. We'll have to see tomorrow, which I will be playing along with everyone else. Eiyuden Chronicles is out and has some bugs that the studio Rabbit and Bear are working on fixing. Of course, the reviews are out as well. The studio did announce it will move forward with the sequel, even though the creator did pass recently. We talked about that in the show, but they're going to be moving forward with a sequel without the creator, which, you know, that's their right to do, of course. Eiyuden Chronicles looks like not as good as I was hoping it to be, but, you know, no one really makes the Suikoden games anymore. Right, Konami, of course, will never make one. No one really has tried to make a Suikoden game like that. So this might be the closest I get. So I guess I can't get too picky with this. But it sounds like it's great. Like I said, there's a couple bugs that I honestly might be waiting for to be fixed before I really, really crack it open. But aside from that, it seems like it's living up, maybe, to the hype. Moon Studios' No Rest for the Wicked is in early access currently. I wanted to highlight this as this is a game I was looking forward to, but I'm not really an early access guy. I usually, unless it's like a multiplayer game that I can play with buddies and, you know, there's no story, but I don't really like, you know, like single player games playing like early access. So I'm just going to be waiting for that one. I will not be playing it, but wanted to throw it out there just in case you are interested. Fallout games have exploded in popularity. I just wanted to highlight this because of the Amazon show, of course. Talk a little bit about this because it's even affected my household. My wife is currently playing it now. My father is playing it right now as well. New Vegas, she's playing 4. And it's pretty crazy that the show kind of just sparked that interest again. It has such a unique atmosphere and a unique setting and a unique take on its own universe that I feel like it's the only thing that can really scratch the itch. So I think when you watch the show, you really kind of have to go to the origination. You go back to the games that you love to re-experience them, and it's fun. I'm seeing all these people playing it for the first time or again or another playthrough or just checking in, and it's great. Fallout's great. I love the setting. I can't wait for the next one, whenever that is. I'm sure it won't be for another 10 years, but let's hope they work on another Fallout very soon, because that's what I want. I don't really want to go back to any of the old ones. Eventually I will. The Fallout 4 update is out now. I will be shocked if it is working correctly, but maybe it is. But the current gen update is already out. You can play that on PS5 and Xbox Series X with I think there was like a 60 FPS mode, or there's like a balance mode, I believe. So you can get different modes, and there's little updates here and there. So enjoy that. Hades 2 tech test is underway, including the first major area of the game. The studio plans to enter early access soon following the test. So they said in a blog post, they mentioned that they will be entering early access however long the technical test lasts. So I'm guessing they're just kind of hashing things out, probably checking balance, making sure the game is working properly. And then they're going to go straight into early access the moment the tech test is done. None of this is concrete, though. They didn't say how long this could last. They didn't say at what extent. So I feel like Supergiant's just being pretty chill and mellow with how everything's working out. If it works great, they'll be going into early access sooner. If they need more time, it'll be later. Same thing with No Rest for Wicked, even more so, though, because I am a huge fan of Hades. That might be one of my favorite games of all time. And I'm not touching Hades 2 until it probably is done. I don't really, again, want to, for lack of a better word, playtest the game. I want to play the whole game by itself. Maybe I would be more likely to do it if there were fewer games, but I have too many games to play to really worry about that. So I will be waiting to play the game. Via VGC and was originally spotted by a Twitter user, MaroNL, People Can Fly have canceled a co-op action RPG codenamed Project Dagger after multiple years in development. It was really just set to be published by Take-Two, but the agreement ended September of 2022. We actually talked about that around that time, of course, about the agreement with them and Take-Two ending. Of course, these the People Can Fly, people behind Outriders, I'm sorry. That was, of course, published by Square Enix, and then Bulletstorm, if people remember that game. Bulletstorm was very fun, but Outriders, if we remind ourselves, was not great, well-received in terms of sales. Although I know it had an uptick when they released the expansion, but I remember at the time, People Can Fly mentioned like they didn't see residuals when the game launched, so they assumed it made no money from Square. So I imagine... I'm curious if People Can Fly are doing well right now, you know, canceling a project that late in development. And we're talking maybe six, I think people were throwing around like possibly 6 years, 5 years, somewhere around there. And that's a big price tag. It gets very expensive. I mean, you're paying all the people to work on it, and now all that is gone. And, you know, maybe you spin those assets into another game. And if you don't, you just, you know, wasted all that time and didn't get any fruit out of it. So I really hope they're in a good spot. I like People Can Fly. I think they are pretty talented and they know what they're doing, especially with something like Outriders. I feel like they saw the problem before launching Outriders, already seeing that market being completely overturned with games trying to be Destiny. And I remember announcing before the game even really was out there, saying, hey, this is not meant to be a games as a service. We're going to be releasing this and we're going to be walking away. And if you play that game was clearly meant to be the opposite of that. It was meant to be a Destiny game, but I think they noticed that the stars were not aligning and ripped the parachute out, which is wise, because that meant they could go do something else, or they could, you know, work on that expansion or try to make something else, rather than put all the eggs in a basket and you make a grievous situation that could have cost them much more money. I think that was actually wise, especially now we're even more removed from that situation. Now, of course, this part of the show, we talk about what have you been playing. Now, this is the segment of the show I ask you at home, and I'm going to be talking about what I've been playing. But what have you been playing? Now, you can be playing any sort of video game. You let me know in the comments below. We'll discuss it, and we'll talk about it. Now, I have been playing Destiny 2. That's really all I have been playing. I've been kind of getting ready for the new expansion, been doing the new content. It's called Into the Light. We talked about that a little bit last time on the show, but I've been playing Into the Light. It's good. Very good, actually. I think the new mode, it's kind of like a Horde mode, light. It's a part of a free update, and it's clear, like, meant to be like a precursor to the expansion, because it got delayed, so they made this in like a very little bit amount of time to try and keep us busy and keep hype going for the expansion. And they're slowly rolling out new news about the expansion, so we're starting the quote unquote hype cycle about the new expansion called the Final Shape. So they're gearing up for that with both this update and their regular updates every week with new trailers, new gameplay previews and all these things. So get excited if you are a Destiny fan. I am, so I'm getting very excited to see what the new thing is, and also to see the end of the story, because this will end the story and then we will be moving on, right? So that's also very exciting, so they can move on to something new, and we'll see what that is, with potentially maybe a new game in maybe a year or two. Who knows? Maybe. I think that's all I'm going to talk about what I'd be playing. I've only really started Eiyuden Chronicles to the point where, because I literally started, I just wanted to see what the game looked like. And then I went and saved it. I actually kickstarted it. And I got my copy in a couple days ago. So that was cool to get. I'm going to keep it unsealed because it's on Game Pass right now. So I think I'm just going to play the Game Pass version and maybe keep mine sealed for now. We'll see if I have to cut it open a little later. But right now, be leaving it as it is. I'm very excited to get to it. I will be playing that on and off with Stellar Blade, of course. I think those will kind of complement each other, because one will be kind of, you know, colorful. I'm sure at moments it'll be dark, but then of course Stellar Blade, kind of the opposite, right? It seems very dreary, dark, kind of like a dark sci-fi horror fan, not horror fantasy, sorry, more of like a sci-fi action fantasy a game versus a complete opposite of that almost. Let's go into rumor roundup. According to Insider Gaming's Mike Straw, Bethesda France has been closed. Now, this is unfortunate. This might be actually in the wrong segment of the show, because this is rumor roundup, but it was originally a rumor, but it seems upset by the LinkedIn post by these people, but there was no comment from anyone. It seems to be a part of the giant removal from the Xbox layoff, sorry, I blanked on the name, that was announced months ago now, I want to say. And yeah, this seems to be the case. It didn't seem like there were that many people there. I think it was something like 16 people or something like that in the story. I would hate to get that wrong, so let me go to the story really quick just to make sure. But of course, anyone losing their jobs is sad and unfortunate. So hearts go out to everyone losing their job. This was, yeah, a rumor by Insider Gaming's Mike Straw. So it was open for about 12 years. And then this was a part of the original mass layoffs. The office employed 15 people. So not a huge studio. It might have even, again, not to be rude here. I feel for everyone. I'm just giving my take on it. It might have been viewed as redundant in some points. Maybe they could have moved these whole workforce to somewhere else, because I believe they had a physical office. So, like, you know, they eliminate the rent and all the things that encompass that. Very sad to pull it all down to numbers, but that is unfortunately the reality. Hopefully everyone lands on their feet from Bethesda, France. Tom Henderson has some details over on Insider Gaming, and this was actually a little bit of a good read. So if you want more info, go to his actual thing and make sure you give him a click. Tom Henderson has some details on Assassin's Creed Hex. The main protagonist will be female. Her name will be Elsa. She will have supernatural powers and will be released in 2026 on the AC Infinity platform. So, of course, the AC Infinity platform, long rumored, originally broken by Jason Schreier, I believe. Long rumored kind of platform for AC games moving forward when this thing launches, and it will be like a hub for the games. Have no idea at all what it means. Maybe it will have like a live service effect that you might be, maybe there's like you play certain things and get stuff. I'm not very sure still what this thing is. I've heard multiple people try and explain it, and there's always slight differentials in each kind of telling of what it is. So I just want to see when they announce it at this point, and let's figure out what this even is. Is it literally just a launcher? That doesn't make any sense why they would do that. So it has to be something else other than that. But we'll see. I can't wait for Assassin's Creed Hex, by the way. The thing detailed that you have certain suit attributes. It looks like they saw a clip of the game and then describe what was happening in it. Very cool. Make sure you go give them a click to, of course, support them, and you get the full context of the story too. Known leaker Jonathan has said Watch Dogs, the franchise, is dead. Now, I must admit, although as far as I understand, this is a pretty well-known leaker. I don't think this is anything insane. Is there anyone out there thinking Watch Dogs is popping off at Ubisoft right now? But they are being very sure. Apparently Legion completely axed the franchise. They canceled some projects in motion. It's a shame, because they really had something in Watch Dogs 2. That was a great game. I think that's a great, actually one of their best Ubisoft games, and they just kind of did nothing with it. They kind of had that very cool premise, and then they immediately went with, by the way, now it's Legion and no one's the main character. And I'm like, well, that has the potential of being cool, but for me, it was not. I would love to try it out one day, give it an actual chance, but I don't think that will ever happen. This is too many games to play for me to really justify going to Watchdog Legions. Next up, this was a weird one. Sony in talks to bring Helldivers to Xbox. This was via the Xbox Era podcast. They are in the show actually regularly, I would say maybe bi-monthly or something, with them, something them saying. I can't imagine this is true, but hey, you know, Xbox Era do get things right. Of course they do get things wrong. They do kind of have a Jeff Grubb essence to themselves, where they just kind of say things. And I think this is an example of that, where, you know, not that they're just, not like they're intentionally lying or anything. I'm saying they say things as like, oh, I heard this, or, oh, I heard this, I heard this, that. So, you know, X, Y, Z, they're being very truthful with that. They're saying, hey, I've heard a few people reach out and say blah, blah, blah. Doesn't mean that they're saying, hey, I'm basing my entire thing about this. They're very active in like hearing about talking about this. Now, maybe Helldivers has a unique situation with how their licensing work. Now, we could be seeing the, you know what, how about this? Let's do a hypothetical one. Let's just say this is true, right? Let me be clear. I don't think it is, but let's go forward thinking it might be true, and let's go into the mind of a Sony executive or the higher up Sony execs on why they might do something like this, and let's try and rationalize it. Right, so if I'm a Sony exec, you know, I would say, why should Helldivers 2 go to other platforms? You could argue, well, this could be a test. I think it would actually be kind of a smart test, because it's not a PlayStation game, right? It is not a first party. This is not a first party studio. I know a lot of people want to say that. That is marketing nonsense. That is not true. Do not listen to people who say a studio who is not purchased by Sony is not a first party. We are letting marketing influence the way you discuss things. Don't let that happen, right? Listen to the show. I implore you, do not let that happen. That is them trying to steer you. This is a second party relationship. They are still a third party studio outside of this context. So just as a reminder, that's a little bit of a gripe. I've actually heard quite smart and talented people in the industry say things like that, and it doesn't make any sense. I do not care what Sony says what a first party is. We have definitions. So moving forward. So let's say this is 100% true, right? Let's say Sony is in talks for this. So I would say, hey, you know, let's do an experiment. Sony loves experimenting with things. PS Portal is a popular example of that. They wanted to see if they can maybe up engagement rates in these things. I'm sure they got great data on that. Would love to see it one day. So we're going into the Sony exec mind. You would say, hey, you know, this is a test. Does this affect our platform in any negative way? Maybe we could do a limited window and still make extra money off of a limited time deal. Hey, you know, we'll fund X game, we'll publish it for less money for a cut of your sales moving forward when you go multi-platform after a year of exclusivity or something like that. Maybe you can get something granular as that. Maybe it's something along the lines of, hey, there is no reason to not get this because maybe they have something where it's like we get a cut of the virtual currency in the game. Maybe they have some sort of agreement like that or something of that nature. You know, at that point, you're like, well, I want as many people as playing the game as possible because that fuels that in-game currency, which will not only get us in the back end, but of course affect X, Y, and Z or something like that. And it does semi fall apart because we don't know the specifics of how they're making money. Maybe it's just a straight rip of X percent of every sale. Maybe it's everything. You know, I'm not really sure. At this point, it seems like Sony doesn't really care about Helldivers. Even after its supposed success, which is strange, right? I don't necessarily blame them for not calling out Helldivers. They clearly send it out, not necessarily to die, but they kind of send it out as a, you know, hey, this is our partnership. We're going to kind of send it out. Let's see what happens. And if we look at their behavior around that time, they didn't really spotlight it. It wasn't really blog posts. There wasn't previews, no beta. You know, it didn't really seem like PlayStation was really putting its best foot forward. Not really gameplay showcases. It was just a couple very commercially looks at state of plays, so not really highlights or anything centered around it. So it really didn't feel like they cared about it. And then now it's exploded, and I mean literally exploded in popularity to the point where they couldn't even maintain the game, right? They couldn't maintain the game with how much server load they were having. They had to get more servers twice, I believe, multiple times over. The people working there didn't expect this success. PlayStation didn't expect this success. And now it seems like PlayStation still doesn't care, which is even more interesting because we're now a little bit away from the release. You would think we would see PlayStation kind of buddying up now, being like, hey, you know, that was a great release. Let's do XYZ. Maybe we're still not far enough away to notice it, but I don't see PlayStation really pimping this out. You know, when I log in on my PlayStation, I'm not really seeing banners for it. I'm not seeing, and maybe it's because I own the game already. But, you know, I'm not really seeing much kind of contributing to it. But, of course, video game industry is slow, right? You can't really reactionary to something to this extent. So maybe they are in full talks in the back end and having discussions. As a reminder, they are not purchased. Arrowhead is not purchased by Sony. The CEO recently said they are not bought because there was a rumor that they were being bought. He flat out said it was not true, which very shocking to see a CEO even say that. But he did do that. So that is a little mirror into the Arrowhead Sony situation. And I went off a little bit about the whole first party thing. It just bothers me that people say that. I don't know. We have definitions here, right? We already kind of have a trouble communicating in this industry for multiple reasons. And that's one of them, I feel like. That is an issue I think we have, right? Being clear with what we're saying, because you know, when we say roguelikes, roguelites, Dark Souls, Souls-likes, I think Souls-likes is actually a recent example of kind of struggling what to call something, right? When we look at a Souls-like and you hear that name, what do you think of? Because I think of something probably completely different than what you think of. So we do really, you know, we really should sit down someday as an industry. Maybe it should be like a GDC talk or something and just be like, hey, what does these things mean? Because they're kind of important, right? In like the discussion, but I don't know. I'm just thinking outside the head. Let's move on. Tom Henderson via Twitter says this. let me start over. Tom Henderson via Twitter is saying this about Division Heartland. Quote, I've seen a lot of people wondering if the Division Heartland has been canned or not. It hasn't, but it has gone through some significant changes since we last heard about it. We'll report more after I pin down more details, end quote. I wanted to bring that up because I can't wait to see more about this. This was kind of heated up for a little bit, I feel like, with Division Heartland. Now, if we remember, they have that Division Mobile game. What is that called? Division Mobile. Division Mobile game is called Resurgence. I think that's already out, isn't it? I think it is. Pretty sure it is. There was a closed beta. I'm pretty sure this thing's out. Honestly, no one I think listening to this cares if it's out or not. So let's move on. But it seems like they focused on that for a little while, and then Heartland, maybe something happened to it, or maybe it wasn't fun, or maybe something positive happened and they're like, hey, this is really good. Let's like really put our backing into it and make this a bigger launch. Because if we remember correctly, this was like a expansion, correct, for Division 2. Originally, when it was announced, what, 2022? 21? Something like that? I think it was 2022. And we haven't heard really much about it. Other than, like, a little bit of... I think we saw, like, a trailer since then or something like that. But it's all been quiet, so I can't wait to really see this. I want to see more. I want to see where this is coming from. I want to see more. I don't have much to say about this. I love Division. I love Division 1 and 2. I can't wait for another one. So maybe they're going to make this just a sequel and just make it a huge kind of, hey, this is a new Division. Enjoy. Blam. You know, maybe they see a sweet spot in the Destiny 2 situation. Hey, it's ending. Maybe a bunch of players are leaving that player base. Maybe we go, bam, 3 months later, here's a giant game called Division Heartland. And you know, enjoy it here. Maybe that's the case. I'm not really sure, but that's a couple things I wanted to highlight, as maybe we'll hear something more about it. All right, I look a little cleaner now. I had to stop for a second and took advantage of the situation and made myself a little bit more presentable. Let's start the show for the week because no one cares about what I look like. It is a new week, which can only mean one thing. Yes, of course, we have yet another Embracer Group story, but this time it seems to be the beginning of the end of these constant updates that we've been doing because this dying company may be going away for a while is in terms of needing to talk about it and give it constant updates, as Embracer Group itself will be splitting into three separate companies. Those companies are Middle Earth Enterprises and Friends, Coffee Stain and Friends, and Asmodee Group. The current listing of the Embracer Group as a public company in the NASDAQ and the actual public stock trading network will be renamed to Middle Earth and Friends. Asmodee will be listed as a separate company within a year, and Coffee Stain and Friends will be in 2025. So this is finally happening. They have actually died in front of our faces. They entered and left almost as fast as they came into the picture. Embracer Group, I mean, what do I have to say that I haven't said every week? They were almost like a leech on the industry. And I think everything makes sense in hindsight. And I was saying this going in as it didn't make any sense that this company wanted to be the biggest company publisher than anyone. It had more people than PlayStation, Nintendo under them, way more studios, hundreds of games development reported from them, just an absolute nonsense all around company. Lars Wingfort being the like kind of mastermind behind everything. I never want to see him anywhere around the games industry again. Apparently he is smart. There's like a couple interviews and things you can read about, but I mean, you don't make that much money without being somewhat smart, but he made a bet and it completely blew up in his face. And I can't imagine, I can't imagine ever seeing that guy again. Maybe, but they're going to try and keep this thing going with Middle Earth and friends. I assume they're going to try and salvage together some games, maybe. Maybe they're going to try and license out the IP to people to try and make some quick bucks. But I want to remind everyone, the Embracer Group got all these entities to sell, to try and sell it off. He had no intention of actually working with all of these entities. He never wanted to make games. I think it's obvious because we never saw an actual push for games. It just seems like they all were eaten up and gobbled into this amalgamation, and then they just worked on what they were already working on, and they weren't really given any guidance. As far as I understand, they released like some remakes and like a SpongeBob game into these things, and just random things that were already enveloped, so it didn't even matter. And it blew up in his face. He had no intention of keeping this thing. He wanted to sell it off. If not sell it off, get a good bit of money, maybe leave after a certain amount of time with the Saudi group, which is who we assume. And we pretty much know at this time it was probably the Saudi group, and they left them out to dry at the last hour of the deal. And it is pretty crazy that this guy came in. It's not just that guy. It's a lot of people involved, but a lot of people involved came in. They fucked everything up. And now they're gone, and they're also rich. Nothing happened to them. Nothing bad will happen to them. But a bunch of these companies are fucked. A lot of the working man got screwed over because they were just kind of playing chess, and the board fell. So feel bad for everyone affected by this. Hopefully this is the beginning of the end of this. Hopefully it is smooth sailing from now. I doubt it, but I just have no confidence for any of this, but maybe they'll make a best out of a bad situation. I would hope many people would see the opportunity and just get out as soon as they can to see if they can find another job. Because that company must be horrible. I mean, they just are idiots over there. I'm not trying to, I don't know, that's maybe a little too mean, but it makes me really upset to see what they did to the industry I like. And I wish everyone the best of luck, I guess. Hopefully people figure it out. And that's going to be the show for a week. I don't really have much else to talk about with the Embracer Group, but like I said at the beginning of the show, it's a shorter week, so it's a lighter news week. We're trudging along in a very quiet time. I'm excited for when the dominoes fall. Something will fall. Will it be Xbox? Will it be PlayStation? I don't know. Right now, the closest thing we have is June with the Xbox Showcase. And if nothing happens until then, I mean, wow, that would be quite a drought that we would have to sustain until we get somewhere, right? I can't think of anything majorly happening, but, you know, surprises are always abound. But I can't wait. I cannot wait. Maybe at some point we'll get a little Grand Theft Auto update randomly dropped, and that'll be a big news. But right now, news is kind of light. So let's go to date updates. Now, this is just Game Pass for the week. Let's talk about it, not for the week, you know, the little update for the week. Let's go into Game Pass. So, available as of recording. Herald Halibut Cloud PC Xbox Series S and X. That's a day one on Xbox title. And then, let's see here. Orcs Must Die 3 Cloud Console and PC. EA Sports NHL 24 EA Play. Again, already available. Eiyuden Chronicles 100 Heroes Cloud Console PC available day one on Game Pass April 23rd. I cannot wait to more people to play this game. Hopefully you like it. I will be delving into it. Right now, I'm really stuck on Stellar Blade. I thought I was going to swap back and forth. I think I'm actually going to focus on Stellar Blade, do the Platinum, and then go into Eiyuden. Because we have quite a long period before a lot of games come out. So I have some time to kind of relax. So I think I'm going to play more Stellar Blade first and then go into Eiyuden Chronicles. Next up, another game I was looking forward to and a game I've talked in the show, another Crab's Treasure Cloud Console PC. That is available day one on Game Pass as well. I will be playing this for sure. I will definitely be playing this at some point. It will not be right now. I am too busy, but I can't wait to try this out. It was a cute little game. You play as a crab. You get little different hermit shells out of like kind of trash and you play with the game. I can't wait. Manor Lords game preview PC April 26th. Apparently, this is kind of popping off. This is another day one Game Pass. It's a medieval strategy game. Apparently, people are really liking it. So keep an eye on that. Maybe you'll want to look at it. And of course, it's on Game Pass. You can try it out via game preview. Have a Nice Death Cloud Console and PC. And then there's more games being added to Game Pass Core. That's, of course, the first subscription service of Game Pass. If you do not have Ultimate and you just have the first one, this is things added to Core on April 23rd. So already added, Wreckfest, Super Hot, Mind Control, Wreckfest, Super Hot, Mind Control, Delete, and then Deep Rock Galactic. Some very good games added to Game Pass Core. And this is everything leaving at, pretty much as you're hearing this. 7 Days to Die, Besiege, EA Sports, NHL 2022, Loot River, Pikuniku, what the hell? And Ravenlock. That's everything leaving the service on April 30th, which is probably when you're hearing this. That was date updates. Now let's get into, of course, a single question that I ask you at home, and I will be answering while I'm here. What's queued up for the week? Now, this could be a game, a TV show, a movie, podcast, a book, an audiobook, really anything. What do you have queued up for the weekend? Now, I have Stellar Blade. And that's pretty much it. I really want to focus on Stellar Blade right now. I'm kind of in the mood for this game. This game is really hitting a lot of the notes I want to hit. And I'm excited. I'm excited to really feel the excitement of this game, I guess. I'm trying to find a better way of putting it. Like, the game really is exciting to play. I like finding the new enemies. I like finding the new little gadgets and things. I just got my first kind of major upgrades in the game. I don't think this is a spoiler. I'm in the first major area, I guess I should say, after the beginning part of the game. I'll try to be vague. But I'm loving this game right now. It's just, I don't know. It seems like it's exactly when I wanted to play when it came out. I've kind of been in a lull since Rebirth because I loved Final Fantasy Rebirth so much that I just kind of, I don't know. I didn't really get into anything else. I was just kind of chilling. And with Rebirth, it was so good, it kind of hit me for other games. I didn't want to play anything else. And this is kind of, I don't know, maybe this is similar but different enough that I can get back in, but this definitely brought me back in, so I'm excited for that. I'm very, very actually excited for that, and I'm happy to be playing again because I was kind of relaxing from playing. I was only really playing Destiny on and off and hanging out with some friends, so it makes me happy to be back. But aside from that, that is going to be the show for the week. I don't really have anything else that's queued up. We're rewatching The Office, which is always a great time, but I don't think I need to bore anyone. And everyone knows The Office is a good show at this point, or you don't like it. So I don't think I need to talk to anybody about The Office at this point. But aside from that, I want to thank everyone for stopping by for the show. Thank you for listening all the way through, for, of course, not only the algorithm, but also showing that you like the show. Comment below with any issues or, you know, anything you want to talk about, comments, complaints, really anything. I answer every YouTube comment, pretty much ever. So until the next time, go Chief.